The COVID-19 pandemic was quite recent, and a lot of us probably would like to forget about it. I think it was a difficult experience for a lot of people, and I think that's why we sort of want to collectively put it behind us. But actually, there's a lot we can learn from it. And myself and the rest of the team are trying to figure out what the unanswered questions are that people still have, and hopefully start to provide some answers. Hi.
Morning.
How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. What have we got here? It looks like a toy shop. So what always terrifies me is, what if it happens again? Is it going to happen again? Do we know? Because all the time, we know we're getting new viruses, I believe. You know, you hear about, there's a new strain coming. Is that going to cause a pandemic?
So a lot of the questions we got were actually about future pandemics, and were they likely? What kind of virus could it be? And of course, these are very good questions and the kind of thing that we're working on all the time.
Hello.
Hannah,
come on in. Come on in.
Thank you. Thank you for having
me. Let's take your coat and bag and things and
make you comfortable.
Right, here we are. Have a seat.
Thank you, Harry, for inviting me here today. As you know, we're doing public engagement projects about pandemics and unanswered questions and trying to figure out what people are still wondering. So I'd love to hear a bit about how your experience was during the pandemic.
Well, thank you for the meeting. I mean, it's...
Thank you.
it was quite limiting, as you can imagine. I mean, as you know, we were forbidden from seeing friends and family, and so it was quite a lifestyle change, really.
Yeah.
And it suddenly made you realise that this was something that really we ought to plan for. One of the things I was going to ask you is that there's a worry that it might happen all over again. So is it a real imminent danger to us, or?
Yeah, I mean, so it is probably likely that we might see another pandemic at some point, maybe in our lifetimes. But that's why a lot of researchers are trying to kind of get ahead of that. So a lot of countries thought they had pandemic plans, but COVID showed us that they were really not that good.
No.
So a lot of countries are trying to take lessons from that, build these pots of funding for research, and also do a lot of preventative research. So that's why there's a few different organizations that put together a list of priority pathogens. So it's pathogens that would have a really high risk, potentially, or maybe as well pathogens where there's not a lot of funding right now. So it could be really dangerous if they spill into the human population, but we're not really well prepared in terms of like therapeutics, diagnostics, vaccines. So we don't know for sure what the next pandemic might be caused by. A lot of people think they're worried about avian influenza, so bird flu, Ebola, other filoviruses like that, or hemorrhagic fevers, which have quite severe symptoms. So yeah, we are trying to plan for that future and come up with different treatments that might work for, you know, a wider range of viruses. So no matter what comes forward, we can kind of be prepared.
The Pandemic Sciences Institute was set up in response to the COVID-19 pandemic to sort of bring together all the things we've learned about pandemics and apply it to potential future pandemics. And the idea in this institute is to better understand these viruses themselves, and we hope that there will be equitable access to the vaccines, therapeutics and control measures that we find.
Basically, viruses are very unstable, so it's very difficult to have a particular vaccine for them.
So I think it's really important to learn about the questions that members of the public have, because ultimately a lot of our funding comes from public bodies and taxpayers' money. And if they are questions that scientists have already answered, then I think it's really important that we communicate that effectively.
Hi guys, how's it going?
Good.
How's it been with the public?
Good.
My name is Caitlin Brady, and I'm in the third and final year of my PhD in clinical medicine studying immunology.
We both
got these four.
So I think the public largely feels relief after the pandemic because we all find it very difficult. My other concern would be that because we were speaking about it nonstop for 2 years, it was the only thing that was on the news, people are now familiar with terminology that they otherwise would not have had access to. So I do think it's created additional worries because people don't necessarily have the accurate definitions for vaccines, don't understand how they work. It creates a lot of additional uncertainty. So at the museum earlier, everyone was wondering why the vaccines were developed so fast.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are kind of concerned about safety because of that, because they usually expect vaccines to take much longer. I think people just don't really realize that during the pandemic, it was such a unique situation in that there was so much more funding and a lot of these sort of new vaccine platforms were actually already in development. So they'd already been extensively tested for other viruses and in animal models. And this was just their first opportunity to be really tested at a large scale.
Yeah, I think the other reason would be the fact that SARS-CoV-2 naturally infects a couple of animal models to test the vaccines. So it meant preclinical testing was much more rapid than it normally can be. Yeah, I think that's another question that we got quite a bit actually, was why we actually have a vaccine against SARS-CoV-2, but we don't have vaccines against a number of other viruses. And largely my argument to that would be the fact that we don't have animal models that can capture that.
Bats are a very important vector for many viruses, and actually their sort of strange interactions with viruses and their immune system means that they can harbor many more viruses than many other mammals can. And their close encounters increasingly with people and other mammals mean that there's more opportunity for spillover, which is when viruses jump between species.
I'd love to hear a bit more about your experience and what sort of questions you still have.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, the experience was, as you know, it was a lockdown and we all had to stay inside, but also, you know, how certain commodities became very rare, even the toilet paper. Now it feels like something, kind of a nightmare. But of course, we lost friends and families in our part of country. I hail from India originally. And as far as I understand, do we actually know now that how the virus originated? Why are bats so important? I mean, why doesn't it affect the bats?
Yeah, so bats are really unique in that they can host a whole range of viruses without themselves getting sick. And the reason why, we think, is because they're so evolutionarily ancient. So they've co-evolved with these viruses for millennia. And they did this as one of the only mammals that are capable of powered flight. So flying is this really metabolically intensive activity and it damages their cells. And normally this would trigger sort of an inflammatory immune response. But because of this, bats have evolved a really tolerant immune system. It means that bats can coexist with viruses without any ill health effects often. So I feel like one of the biggest misconceptions here is that this somehow makes bats the villains. But actually they're really critical for the ecosystem, they're essential pollinators, and they actually control mosquitoes, which actually do spread disease. So the viruses only really spill over from the bats to the people when we cause deforestation and when we encroach on their habitats and we stress them, force them to migrate into human areas, and then they start shedding the virus. But really, if we want to protect ourselves, the best way to do that is to start by protecting the bats.
While we might want to forget about the pandemic, there are many lessons that we can learn. And from our conversations with members of the public, it's clear that there are still many unanswered questions. But working with the public and trying our best to answer them as scientists and continuing to develop the great science that was spearheaded during the pandemic, and we can hopefully be even better prepared for the future. If you'd like to learn more about pandemics and the work we do, please see the link in the description.